In this video, we start the second part of the electrical conversion chapter that is about DC to AC inverters. This second half is subdivided as follows. In this video, after an introduction on solar inverters, we will see the main characteristics of this device. Then, in the next video, we are going to talk about installation concepts and the different topologies that you might encounter when you want to put together different PV panels in a PV system. Thirdly, we will see the basic implementation of a DC to AC conversion. In reality, every inverter brand has its own proprietary topology, so it is virtually impossible to go through all the different nuances of embodiment for a DC to AC inverter. However, in general, there are always an H-bridge along with a control algorithm to modulate the output signal. For this purpose, usually pulse width modulation is used. Then, in the lecture about the overall configurations, we ideally open an inverter and we see what are the different parts involved. In another video, grounding-related issues which can arise when connecting the PV modules to the inverter are treated. Finally, we concluded this series of videos discussing the efficiency of the inverter in order to be able to calculate the overall energy yield of a PV system throughout the entire year. Coming back to this slide that summarizes the most important components forming a PV system, we can find the inverter again in the balance of the system block. It is very important to note that the term inverter can have two different meanings. First, it is used for the actual inverter, which is the electronic device that performs the DC to AC immersion, as we are going to see. Secondly, the term inverter is also used for the total unit produced by manufacturers, and thus, depending on the application, it may contain a maximum power point tracker, a DC-DC converter, and a DC to AC inverter. In grid-connected systems, the inverter is connected directly to the PV array and converts the DC electricity coming from the PV array into AC electricity. Besides, such an inverter usually contains a maximum power point tracker system. As such an inverter is connected to the electricity grid, it must also synchronize with the grid, meaning that the phase angle of the AC signal coming from the inverter must equal to that of the grid. In order to increase power quality of the grid, the injected signal should also have a minimal harmonic content. Let's now see the main characteristics of a solar inverter, intended as the power electronic device that actually performs the conversion from direct current to alternate current. In general, an ideal solar inverter should fulfill the following requirements. First, it should be highly efficient because the owner of the solar system requires the absolute maximum possible generated energy to be delivered to the grid or to the load. To meet this goal, we seek for solutions that can ensure low losses. Sometimes special demands about grounding need to be met. We will come back to this aspect at the end of this series of video when we will talk about potential induced degradation. Some additional circuitry is often included to make sure that if any high frequency harmonics are traveling along the cables, they will not go towards the PV modules nor the grid. This requirement is enforced by law in most countries since the harmonic limits of both sources and loads connected to the grid are regulated. Special requirements exist also for electromagnetic interference, which is regulated by law in most countries. The goal is to minimize the unwanted influence of electromagnetic interference on other equipment in the vicinity of or connected to the same supply. Then, in many instances, the PV system needs to be installed outdoors, and the inverters should meet certain specifications regarding temperature and humidity conditions. Of course, more expensive solutions exist in case of inverters that have more stringent capability against dust or outside operation. The embodiment is usually classified according to the IP standard, which rates the degree of protection provided against intrusion. IP45 means that dust do not enter in sufficient quantity to interfere with the satisfactory operation of the equipment. In particular, the second digit, 5, indicates the level of protection against water jets coming from any direction. Usually, the device has to be designed for a high ambient temperature and 20 years of operation, although most of the time brands offer warranties ranging around 15 years. Nowadays, these components are becoming more and more reliable, but power electronics and batteries still remain the most fragile part when it comes to maintenance, while PV panels are usually the sturdiest part of the PV system. Last aspect to take into account is silent operation, so no audible noise. Often for inverters, when a loud clicking noise can be heard, it might be a signal of malfunctioning of the chopping section. When designing a PV system, a crucial part is the choice of the inverter. In particular, apart from all the aspects we have mentioned so far, the choice between a single-phase inverter and a tri-phase inverter is really important. A household is normally served by single-phase AC power, so this is the best choice for low-power systems and in general for standalone applications. If the photovoltaic system is connected to the grid, the single-phase option can still be considered. Issues arise when the power injected into only one phase is too high. In that case, one of the phases would carry too much current, causing an imbalance in the system which compromises the stability of the grid. Generally, a tri-phase inverter is instead used when a 5 kilowatt peak threshold is reached. In this case, the current will be directly balanced throughout all the phases. We will see more in depth the two topologies of inverter in the next video. As already mentioned, the word inverter might refer either to the DC-AC converter or to the power electronic unit that includes many other things inside. So, for example, we can have the maximum power point tracker, the DC-DC converter, the DC-AC converter, and some models even include a battery charge controller in it. Indeed, in an inverter, DC power is transformed into AC power, but the DC input voltage of the inverter is always constant, while the output voltage of the module set, MPP, is not. Therefore, a DC-DC converter is used to transform the variable voltage from the panels into the constant voltage seen by the DC to AC inverter. Additionally, the maximum power point tracker controls the operation point of the modules, but cannot set it. And this is also done again by the DC-DC converter. The topology with a battery charge controller is typically used in standalone applications, which include a battery system, but that still are connected to the AC loads. In this case, all these components are fully integrated in the inverter. Let's now recap what we have seen in this video. First of all, the inverter belongs to that part of the PV system which is called the balance of system, or BOS. Then we went through the main characteristics that every inverter shows. Also, we saw that depending on the size of the system and the application, a choice has to be made between a single-phase and three-phase inverter. Finally, we clarified that the word inverter can refer either to the power conversion section that modifies the signal from DC to AC, or to the overall power electronic device that includes also other components. In this video, we talked only about the inverter as a component. In the next video, we are going to see how the inverter is used in different types of PV systems configuration.